Ambassador Grossman, welcome to VOA.
Thank you very much for having me.
Let's start with your trip to the region. You went to several countries. There was talk of a possible office for the Taliban in Qatar. What progress did you meet during this trip, and where exactly do you stand in the process right now?
First of all, thank you very much for the opportunity. We're working on the instruction we were given by Secretary Clinton last February, in February 2011, to try to create a diplomatic effort to see if it's possible to bring peace and reconciliation to Afghanistan in a negotiated way. And the most important part of that is to get Afghans talking to other Afghans. This isn't about the United States, it's not about other countries, it's about Afghans talking to one another. And so the trip I took, I went to Turkey and to Saudi Arabia, to the UAE, to India, Afghanistan, then Doha, back to Rome. And the whole purpose was to see if we couldn't support Afghans talking to Afghans. To do that, we've pursued a number of channels to do that. As you say, you know, a lot of talk about the possibility of an office here, the possibility of an office there. But those questions are really for Afghans to answer, and our job is to be in support of that. As I said, in Kabul, if there was to be an office in Qatar, there's still some work to do to get that job done. The Taliban needs to make some statements. The Qataris need to be in touch with Afghans. So there's still some work to do, but I thought we made some modest progress.
Can you confirm that the U.S. is actually talking to Taliban at this time? And if so, what are you guys talking about at this stage?
Well, you'd be astonished if I answered that question. What we're trying to do is exactly what the Secretary asked us to do, which was to use our contacts in the region to talk to people with only one purpose, and that purpose is to get Afghans talking to other Afghans about the future of Afghanistan.
But does that mean, yes, you are talking to Taliban about talking to other Afghans?
As I said, I think you'd be amazed if I answered that question. You know, it doesn't suit me or I think anybody else to say, I did this, I did this, I did this. Our job is to support the efforts that the Secretary of State has given us to do, and also to support the efforts of Afghans to talk to other Afghans about Afghanistan.
You're talking about Afghans talking to Afghans, and yet there are reports in the media that the Karzai government feels left out and is trying to start a parallel track in Saudi Arabia with the possibility of an office in Saudi Arabia. What do you know about that? And if that is true, then how does it impact the track that you're working on?
That's a very good question. I'd say three things. First, on the question of keeping the Afghans in this process, I think the idea that somehow they were misled or sidelined is really wrong. I think everyone who's been involved in this, again, has had only one purpose, and that's to get Afghans in the lead of this, an Afghan peace process for Afghans. So how the Afghans proceed on this, what they choose to do, really is up to them. And President Karzai, I think, has always talked about the importance to him of Saudi Arabia. You'll recall that in his speech to the Bonn conference, he thanked one country for their help in reconciliation, and that was Saudi Arabia. And so however this takes place, wherever this takes place, the important thing is that Afghans talk to Afghans about the future.
An Obama administration official told the New York Times that the Taliban particularly wanted an office in Qatar and not in Saudi Arabia because of, quote-unquote, they didn't want to be under the thumb of the Pakistanis or the ISI. Can you confirm that?
Well, there are many opportunities for this office. You know, when you listen to President Karzai and others, I think I would agree with him that where this office ought to be is it ought to be in Afghanistan. It should be in Kabul. And so anything that we choose, or anything the Afghans choose, really is an interim solution, whether that's in Turkey or Saudi Arabia or Qatar. The reason people have kind of landed on Qatar as a possibility is that that's a place where the Taliban might be comfortable. It's a place where the Afghan government might be comfortable. But as I said in a previous answer, there's still some work to be done before such an office would be officially established. But again, the important thing is interim. Ultimately, this conversation should take place in Afghanistan. And when President Karzai says that, he's right.
Has the U.S. softened its demand for the Taliban to enter the peace negotiations? There used to be a lot of prerequisites: ceasefire, lay down your arms, recognize the Afghan constitution, and we don't hear that anymore.
Well, with respect, I don't think that's right. Now, if you go back to what the Secretary of State said on the 18th of February, 2011, she said there were three end conditions, not preconditions, end conditions, for us to talk to the Taliban. One, break with Al-Qaeda. Two, stop the violence. And three, respect the Afghan constitution, including, very importantly, the role of women, minorities, individual rights. But she said those were end conditions, that anyone who wanted to to reconcile had to meet those conditions. She did not set them as preconditions. And so I think it's only fair to say that whenever we speak, wherever we talk, we're always referring to those three end conditions. I did it actually in Kabul in my press conference there last week.
The State Department has said that Pakistan has a very important role in Afghanistan. How do you see that role? What, in your opinion, is Pakistan's role in Afghanistan?
Well, I think Pakistan has a hugely important role to play in any peaceful solution in Afghanistan. As Secretary Clinton said that last February, you can't conceive of a solution, peaceful solution in Afghanistan, which the Pakistanis are not comfortable with. They're neighbors. They're part of this. And so we want the Pakistanis to participate in some useful way. And I think that's what they did on April 26th of last year, or 16th, when they went to Kabul and talked about their support for Afghan-led reconciliation. It's why with Pakistan, Afghanistan, the United States, we're all members of this core group to talk about the future, and I hope it'll meet again. And it's why we try to keep our Pakistani colleagues informed about what we're trying to do on reconciliation.
And yet you weren't able to go to Pakistan on this particular trip, and there's a lot of news and rumors about why that happened. Did Pakistan refuse your request to make a stopover in Islamabad?
Well, I don't think there should be any mystery or rumor about this, and I've spoken about it a number of times. The Pakistani parliament, the Pakistani government, are currently reviewing their relations with the United States. And I respect that. They should have time and space to do that. And so they asked for time, they asked for space, they weren't ready, and I respect that as well. And when people are ready in Islamabad to talk about these things or anything else, I'm sure I'd be glad to come, or anyone else they'd like to see.
The French have announced an early withdrawal. Do you think that's going to be a rush to exit by all the other NATO allies?
I don't. I think NATO has for many years worked on the premise of in together, out together. And it'll surely be a conversation here, I think, on Thursday or Friday with defense ministers in Brussels, and then again in Chicago. So I certainly understand kind of the motivation here, I mean, when the terrible death of these soldiers. But I think NATO will commit to in together, out together.
Let's move on to another subject. You were the last person to see the former ambassador Hussein Haqqani when he left for Pakistan, and now he's been allowed to leave from Pakistan. How do you feel about it, and as he's coming back to the U.S. but not as an ambassador, you know, how do you see his return?
Well, what Ambassador Haqqani does and where he goes is obviously up to him. We've said from the very beginning that we hoped whatever process there was in Pakistan would be transparent and would be expeditious. And we think the fact that he's now able to travel is an excellent development. And how he decides to spend his time is obviously up to him.
There seemed to be a lot of activity in U.S. while he was in Pakistan. There were statements from the State Department. There were letters sent to the State Department by people. What kind of back-channel diplomacy was going on as he was in Pakistan?
Well, I don't think there was any back-channel diplomacy. There was open diplomacy, which is that our statements in public, the letters we wrote to people, the answers the Secretary of State gave to this question were exactly the same message we were giving in private. So nothing different in public or private on this question.
You mentioned the review that's going on in Pakistan with, you know, how they want to proceed with relationships with the U.S. The few points of contention that they have seem to still be there. The drone strikes after moratorium have resumed. The November 26th incident in which Pakistan demanded an apology did not get the kind of apology that they wanted. So what are your expectations from this review?
Well, first, we'll wait and see what the review has to say. I mean, the review is Pakistan's business, and Pakistan is a sovereign country and can say whatever it wants. What we'd like to see going forward is a relationship with Pakistan where we can identify our shared interests and act on them jointly. Let me take the question of terrorism, for example. Every time I think about Pakistan, I think about the 19,000 Pakistanis that have been killed in recent years in terrorist attacks. And that ought to be something that Pakistan and the United States can work together on. I hope that whatever review comes out and whatever conversation follows the review, that we can have a respectful relationship and then an active relationship, because on counterterrorism, nuclear questions, Afghanistan, many other questions, there are things that the United States and Pakistan can do together, and we ought to do them.
As my last question, let me ask you, you're sitting here, you're talking to Pakistani people, this interview is going to be aired in Pakistan, where a lot of people think, frankly, that the U.S. is overbearing, interfering, self-centered, and bossy. What would you like to say to them?
First of all, the most important thing I'd like to say to the people of Pakistan is that we respect the people of Pakistan. That's why we are trying to pursue policies in terms of civilian assistance, support for the democratic government, and this idea, I think, that we ought to be able to find our shared interests and act on them together. And so my message to people in Pakistan is, we ought to be able to go about this with mutual respect. And if we do that, I think we'll be fine.
Thank you very much, Ambassador Grossman.
Thanks a lot. I really appreciate it.